Hello everyone, welcome to Achievers IAS classes. Let's begin our discussion on the current events of 28th Feb 2018. The first issue in news is regarding the recent decision of the Haryana government to make the existing criminal laws related to sexual offences against women and children more stringent by enhancing punishments up to death penalty. The amendments include rigorous imprisonment for a term of not less than 14 years for a crime of rape on a girl up to 12 years of age, imprisonment and fine for individuals who commit crimes outraging the modesty of women, which includes stalking of women. We'll further discuss the efficacy of these amendments in deterring rape in the days to come. Till then, let's move on to the next issue, which is an editorial regarding the recent Delhi High Court's order striking down a discriminatory exclusion clause in health insurance policies. The case in point involved a petitioner with a rare heart condition based on which the insurance company rejected the claim of the petitioner, viewing it as a manifestation of a genetic disorder. Such exclusion defeats the very purpose of having a health insurance policy. And in many cases, the insurance policy favors the insurer rather than the insurance policy holder, because the fine print of these policies contain a plethora of exclusions which are not often understood by the policy holder. The court in this regard, by ordering to strike down such exclusionary clauses, has upheld the rights of an individual, which include right to health under Article 21 of the Constitution. This is also in line with the center's commitment to a universal national health protection scheme to prevent the huge out-of-pocket expenditure arising due to healthcare needs. What needs to be understood is, in India, health insurance covers only 29% of the households according to the National Family Health Survey, and the healthcare system in place lacks any regulation of the cost of access to healthcare. Adding to this, the asymmetry of information between the insurer and the insurance policy holder denies the individual from accessing quality healthcare. Such questions led to the enactment of a new healthcare law in the United States during the previous administration, whereby strict obligations were placed on insurers and unreasonable exclusions were removed. And since India's health insurance and hospital sectors closely follow the American pattern, there is a need for strong regulation to curb frauds and empower patients to uphold their right to access quality healthcare. Therefore, the Delhi High Court order, observing that exclusions cannot be unreasonable or on a broad parameter such as genetic disposition, is a step in the right direction. Going forward, the insurance law in the country has to be revisited so as to ensure that there is a guaranteed renewal of policies, there is no bar for entry based on age, and pre-existing conditions are uniformly covered. Coming to the problem of exclusion, it can be eliminated if the financing to the insurance policy is done by the government and the coverage is universal. Therefore, the government in the short term should prioritize to remove discriminatory clauses and expand coverage of health insurance to as many people as possible. Having said that, let's move on to the next issue, which is regarding the recent assurances given by the Prime Minister to Korean firms that their investments in India would be protected, and calling upon them to invest more in India, highlighting the huge market and enabling policy environment of the country. A point to remember from the examination perspective is, Korea ranks 16th in terms of FDI equity inflows to India, and more than 500 companies, including Samsung, LG and Hyundai, have operations in India. Having said that, let's look into the next issue, which is an editorial on the recent actions of the Financial Action Task Force, which monitors countries on action taken against terrorist financing and money laundering, placing Pakistan back on its watch list or the grey list. The decision was both appropriate and overdue, given Pakistan's blatant violations to crack down on groups banned by the Security Council 1267 Sanctions Committee that monitors groups affiliated to the Taliban, such as the Lashkar-e-Taiba, Jaish-e-Mohammed, etc. The leaders of these organizations, like Hafiz Saeed and Masood Azhar, continue to hold public rallies in Pakistan, thereby freely raising donations and garnering support from various sections of the society. Also, even though the 1267 Sanctions Committee banned these terrorist entities from getting any funds, Mumbai terror attacks mastermind Zaki-ur-Rahman Lakhvi received the bail amount and Pakistani authorities have lost track of him since his release. In this background, the FATF plenary meeting, which was held recently, failed to reach consensus needed to list Pakistan, despite a formidable resolution proposed by US, UK, France, and Germany. This was mainly due to the initial support for Pakistan coming from countries like China, Saudi Arabia, Turkey, and the Gulf Cooperation Council, which is a cause of concern for India, given the recent diplomatic outreach to these countries by the Indian government. What we need to understand is, this is not the first time that Pakistan has been included under the watch list of FATF, and the present listing will not miraculously change Pakistan's behavior. But if the grey listing comes as a part of a concerted campaign to hold Pakistan accountable for its actions by mounting pressure on the financial infrastructure and targeted sanctions imposed against specific law enforcement and intelligence officials, it might persuade Pakistan to stop state support for these terror groups and become a responsible player on the global stage. On that positive note, let's move on to the next issue, which is regarding criticism of the US president on import duties imposed by India on imported motorcycles. The US president further has said that Prime Minister Narendra Modi has personally assured him to cut tariffs, but India has not officially announced its decision in this regard on imported motorcycles. Towards this, the Society of Indian Automobile Manufacturers have said that the demand for zero duties on imported Harley-Davidson motorbikes is unfair because India has already cut the custom duties on imported high-end motorcycles to 50%, and further reduction could adversely affect the domestic manufacturing industry. Having said that, let's look into the next issue, which is regarding the upcoming visit of President of Vietnam to India. The two countries are expected to discuss issues relating to the South China Sea, given Beijing's claim over most of the area, causing fears and displeasure in the countries of the neighborhood. Vietnam has been one of the most vocal critics of Beijing's expansion in South China Sea due to the importance of the region, both geostrategically as well as for economic reasons. Having said that, let's look into the next issue, which is regarding the Milan series of multilateral naval exercises. The issue is in news because Maldives has declined an invitation from India to join these exercises hosted by the Indian Navy, stating that due to a state of emergency in the country, participation is unviable. A point to remember from the examination perspective is, the Milan exercise is a congregation of littoral navies conducted biennially by the Indian Navy under the aegis of Andaman and Nicobar Command, and many countries participate in it. This year too, 23 countries have been invited, of which 16 have already confirmed of their participation in the exercise. Having said that, I wrap up today's news analysis. Do share this content if you like it. Thank you for watching. Have a nice day.